Kia ora whānau, ko Erina Ho. It's massive to be the 37th speaker and a whole 3 days of awesome speakers. And I've got a disclaimer for you at this point because I know you're all hanging out for lunch and you're thinking about what's coming up. And there's been a lot of amazing conversation today and in the past couple of days. And so I've got a disclaimer. I'm not going to talk to you about Holochain. I'm not going to talk to you about how I climbed Everest. And I'm also not going to tell you how I pissed off the CIA by turning down the chance to be a spy. So what I am going to talk to you about is just tell you a little bit about a story which has, I guess, been reflected really strongly this week, because I'm not any of those experts. And it's been absolutely phenomenal to share a week with incredible people who have deep-seated knowledge about so many different areas. And it makes you go, oh, God, what's my skill set? And what I've realised, and the piece that I pull together, is the ability to bring people together to talk about this. Because the revolution is not going to happen if we don't bring everybody with us. So what I'm going to do today is just very quickly talk to you a little bit about a journey that I went on to change probably the paradigms of how I saw this. This is the photo that you can see there is, I guess, my last photo of normal, as I describe it. It was the 10th of January 2011. It's my best friend in the photo. She's a teacher. And we're in a building called the Art Centre in Otatahi in Christchurch. And a week later, a friend of ours was tragically killed. And 6 weeks later, we had the February earthquake, which looked a little bit like this. So this was a 6.3 earthquake. Tragically, 185 people in Otatahi lost their lives. And we'd already come through the first earthquake. So we, at this point, we're feeling pretty clever in terms of the things that we'd done. We'd made it through an earthquake with no loss of life. But tragically, this occurred. So there's some shots of it. And basically what happened was that what happens in an earthquake, especially when you're built on a swamp like Otatahi is, this thing called liquefaction happens. And liquefaction, this is silt, right? So silt is like sand and shit, basically. And if anyone says to you, go and shovel sand or go and shovel silt, say no, because it is absolutely the most heavy, disgusting, revolting stuff. And you can see that we're obviously very health and safety approved at this case, at this stage as well, with lots of all of their gear that we should have been. We mobilised what is now called the Student Volunteer Army, and in September of 2010, we moved 40,000 tonnes of silt. And in the February earthquake, we moved 400,000 tonnes of silt. And so it was clearing silt out of people's driveways, connecting with people, having cups of tea, and all it was this community movement. So it's a real privilege to be speaking after Camilla, talking about how we built our community in that wonderfully average city that she describes. But the thing about the Student Volunteer Army is it gave young people a chance to contribute and to buy in and be able to support this. And it led to some pretty amazing opportunities. We got to hang out with some cool people because they realised that there was a voice missing in the rebuild of Christchurch, and that was the voice of youth. And I was really struck by the conversation this morning in terms of bringing young people into that conversation. And so I realised at that stage that my skill set was not being a lawyer, which was the path I was on, but to actually bring people together and to tell those stories so that we can inspire people to we can take the technical knowledge and take it out into the communities to change the world. And the name came from sitting in a room with some Aucklanders, apologies to the Aucklanders in the room, when it was pointed out some of the challenges we were facing in about 2014. And this Aucklander turned around and goes, "You guys just need to change the fucking narrative." And I was kind of struck by that, because that's exactly what we needed to do. So we've got a team of pretty wonderful people, two of whom surprised me today by turning up, who are on the bleeding edge of flexibility, trying to change the narrative. We're trying to talk about how we can do things differently for our rangatahi, for our country, and ultimately for the world. We work bringing ideas to market, we help solve problems, and we do that through conversation and through storytelling. And our mission is to try and increase access and reduce inequality. Because some things happened along the way, right? We started out on this journey, but then I had a son in 2017, and there's actually two other children within the wider team as well now. And what we realised is when we talk about our children and when we talk about our rangatahi, we have a pressing problem. 24% of New Zealand's population are our children, and 27% of people worldwide are also children. And the problems that when we talk about youth manifest themselves most strongly for our youth. I was struck by James's conversation this morning, because in 2050, it's not so much about the fact that I'll be 61, which does scare me a little bit, but the fact that my son will be 33. And so he'll be not that far off the age that I am now, and looking at the point of saying, what did you do to change the conversation? And what did you do to inspire others to come with you? So we're on a mission to try and bring that conversation. We're currently doing a whole lot of things around this country, working with incredible people. And I say, hand on heart, I'm not going to be the person that can explain blockchain to you, but I am the person that if you explain it to me, I can then go and tell others. Let's change the fucking narrative.